Hello.
Hello.
What's your name?
My name's Onkar Judge.
Okay, why are you here, Onkar?
Because I believe I've got what it takes to rate the X Factor.
Are you going to win?
Yes, I am.
Good. Who are you as good as?
Michael Jackson, Daniel Bedingfield, George Michael.
All right.
All right. Here I go then.
What have we done to the world? Look what we've done. What about all the peace that you pledged your only son?
So the reason I wanted to show that clip was because it's from one of my previous former favorite shows, The X Factor, and I'm sure most of us feel the way Paula looks right now when it comes to factoring, and that's exactly what we're going to talk about in today's lesson. So X Factor, factoring, scary, frightened face, like Paula, but hopefully I'm going to iron some things out for you today, and we're going to review factoring. Alright, so speaking of factoring, the most common type of factoring is what's called GCF factoring, or greatest common factor. And this is when we try to find a common factor, a common number that both items share. Sometimes you'll have three items like we have over here. But if we think about 6 and 60, those integers, those numbers, a factor that both of those share is 6, because 6 can go into 6, but it can also go into 60. It also happens to be the greatest common factor, so we want to try to find the largest number. Because 2 would also fit. 2 also can go into 6 and 60, but 6 is the greatest. So some people refer to this also as undistributing, because instead of multiplying or distributing something in, this time we're going to divide something out. So we're going to divide both of those by 6. So we're going to put a 6 out front. And then we want to write kind of the leftover stuff, or in other words, what is left when we do this division. So the 6s cancel out, we're just left with a V. And over here, 60 divided by 6 would give us a 10. So GCF factoring is when we're dividing something out and we're left with a factor that's left over. Notice how if you were to distribute the 6 back in, if you were to multiply everything by 6, you'd have what you started with left. So there is a way to check your factoring. You can always multiply it through. So this would be our final answer for this GCF factoring. Same thing going on here. We want to try to find what does 8 and 48 have in common. Okay, the greatest common factor, that would be 8. But we also have some variables in common, because over here we just had a V, but the 6C did not have a V. Both of these terms right here have X's. So this term has two X's, this one has one X. They both have at least one x in common, so I can write that as well because that's a common factor. They both have an x. So if I divide both of those by x, the eights go away, the x's go away, but since I had two up top, I'm left with just one. Over here, these x's are going to go away, but 48 divided by 8 gives us a 6. Again, you can distribute back in, check your work. You should have your original expression left. This last one's a little bit trickier because we have three terms. This is what's called a trinomial, literally because we have three terms. And I refer to this type of factoring as I am factoring. I don't know if you guys have ever heard that before, but notice how our leading number out here is invisible, but it's kind of understood to be a 1. That's where the I comes into play. So I call this I am factoring. When your term or your trinomial, your three things, start with a 1, I want you to think of two numbers that multiply to 8, that's where the m comes from, but also add to 9. So if we think about some factors of 8, we have 8 and 1, we have 4 and 2. I don't think there's any other factors, but of these factors, which one of these can add to a positive 9? Well, that's this one right here, because if we do 8 plus 1, we get 9. So two numbers that multiply to 8 and add to 9 would give us 8 and 1. So just like how we have two things over here, we have the 8x and the x plus 6, we're going to have two quantities left here as well. We're going to have the 8 and the 1. Notice how they're both positive, so this is really a positive 8 and a positive 1, and since our variables are x's, we're going to put those in there as well. Now remember, just like over here, you can distribute to check your work. So if we distribute in the x, we'll get x squared plus x, If we distribute in the 8, we get 8x plus 8. Combining like terms, we get the 9x in the middle. So notice how we get our original expression back. Okay, so this is checking our work. So our actual factored expression would be x plus 8 and x plus 1. Okay, so hopefully this isn't new to everyone. I think we're used to this basic factoring. All right, going on to the next one. This one is pretty special because we only really have two terms, but if we take a look at the actual terms themselves, they are perfect squares. Okay, x squared is a perfect square, and 16 is also a perfect square. So we call this difference of squares. Difference meaning because we are subtracting. Now, we can rewrite this as x squared plus 0x minus 16. We can turn it into a trinomial, okay, just like we had over here, because notice how we're missing that middle term. We're missing that term that has the single x in it. So since we don't have it, we can actually assume that it's 0. So we're going to turn it into I am factoring. So we want to think of two numbers that multiply to a negative 16 but add to 0. All right, so some things that multiply to 16, we have 1 and 16. We have 2 and 8. We also have 4 and 4. Okay, but our goal with these factors is to try to find a pair that can add to 0. Now, there's no way we can get 0 from 1 and 16. There's no way we can get 0 from 2 and 8. But there is a way we can get 0 from 4 and 4. And the way we can get 0 is if one of those 4s is negative. Notice how also that we wanted them to multiply to a negative 16. So it makes sense that we need a negative number because we need negative 4 times positive 4, which would give us a negative 16. And also negative 4 plus 4 give us that 0. So we'll have an x minus 4 as one of our factors and x plus 4 as the other one. A little shortcut for this one, since these are perfect squares, okay, x squared can start as an x, 16, the perfect square of 16 started as a 4, so notice how we have an x and a 4 in both of these cases. It's just kind of a quick hint to remember that 1 is minus and 1 is plus. But this kind of long way right here is the justification or the reason behind why 1 is a minus and 1 is a plus. Okay, so those are factors for that one. This one has a lot of stuff going on, but the first thing you might want to notice is GCF, because notice how 3 and 75 have a common factor. So always, always, always try to do GCF first. So the largest number that can go into 3 and 75 is 3, so we can pull that out. Those go away, so we're left with x squared and a negative or minus 25. But if we take a look at our leftover stuff, we can probably factor that further. X squared is a perfect square. Okay, it started as an x. And 25 is a perfect square. Okay, it started as a 5. So I'm using a little shortcut that I kind of talked about over here. So since these are both perfect squares, we can break them into two factors, an x and a 5, an x and a 5. One's plus, one's minus, just like we had over here. So this one was kind of a two-step. We did the GCF first to break it down into little pieces, but notice how the remainder, the leftover factor, was able to factor further. So sometimes you might be able to do more than one factoring in one given problem. All right, so moving on, these next two problems are probably the most complicated ones that students really have trouble with, and it's because this one kind of looks like I am factoring. Okay, if I write down the I am again, it looks like it should fit that, but notice how it's not starting with a 1 like our other one did, and since it doesn't fit the I am profile, this is not a 1, okay? It's not representing the I. We cannot do that. So we got to do something a little bit different for this one, and we need to bring in the 6 into play because, after all, everything in this expression is affecting our factors in some way. So we can't just ignore that because it's not a 1. So what we're going to do is label these numbers A, B, and C, just like you kind of would for the quadratic formula, which we're actually going to take a look at later in this video lesson. We can label them A, B, and C, and I'm going to show you a little shortcut how I like to factor these. If you really are interested in the longer version or why this shortcut actually works, I'll be more than happy to discuss that with you in class, but I'm going to show you a little shortcut. So first thing I do is I find A times C, So 6 times 2 gives me 12. And instead of with the I am factoring, we focus on this last number, which is what we want to try to multiply by. This 12 is our new number that we want to multiply, or find some numbers that multiply to 12. So maybe we'll list those factors of 1 and 12, 2 and 6, and 3 and 4. All right, so those are some factors of 12. Now, the b value really stays the same as 7. This is the value that we want to add to. So of these factors that multiply to 12, we want to figure out which ones add to 7 somehow. And it looks like the 3 and 4 are going to work because 3 plus 4 gives us 7. So just like the I am factoring, we're going to take x plus 3 and then an x plus 4. Okay, just like before. But here's the tricky part. Okay, this was a little bit different from before. Instead of looking at the last number, we actually have to multiply these two together. So that's a little bit of a change. But here's another change. Okay, this 6 is affecting our answer. So we're going to take these numbers, take this 3 and 4 that we found, and divide both of them by 6. Okay, so we're going to bring this number into play. If we do that, this 3 divided by 6 can actually change into a 1 over 2. And over here, the 4 over 6 can change into a 2 thirds. Okay. Now, here's another little shortcut. I don't like dealing with fractions. You probably don't like dealing with them either. Okay. They are our friend in most cases, but I don't really feel like dealing with them today. So what I'm going to do is be a little tricky and strategic and take the denominator and move it in front of the x as a coefficient in both of these cases. So we're going to have 2x, okay, moving the 2 out front. The 1's going to stay where it is. If I do the same thing over here, move the 3 out front of the x and keep the 2. All right. So this process is what I call advanced factoring. Because it's a little bit more intense, there's a little bit more steps involved with it, and it's almost a memorization of a process. But again, I'll show you a different way in class. If this is a little much for you to remember, I can show you another way in class. But this is how I do it. If you want to find a different way, don't be afraid to ask, and I'll show that to you in class. Now, if we try this one, remember we should always try GCF first. And we forgot to check that over here, but just looking at 6, 7, and 2, there's no number that all three of those have in common. So GCF, we don't have to worry about. Over here, on the other hand, there is a number that can go into 6, 9, and 60, and that's actually 3. So let's divide all of those by 3. And what's even more important to do is to divide by negative 3. That way we can get rid of this initial negative. Okay, so I like dealing with positive numbers out front, just like this positive 6 was. So let's change this negative number into a positive by dividing by 3. So we're going to put our negative 3 out front that we're dividing by and divide everything out. Negative 3 or negative 6 divided by negative 3 gives us a positive 2. Positive number is always good. Negative 9 divided by negative 3 gives us a positive 3. X, and then we're left with a minus 20. So, taking a look at the remainder factor that we have over here, let's try to factor it further. Now, it's not starting with a 1, so we cannot do that I am factoring. We might want to try something similar to this advanced factoring. So, maybe we'll label A, B, and C and find our A times C, which is 2 times negative 20, which would give us negative 40. And let's list some factors that can multiply to 40. There might be a lot. 1 times 40, we have 2 times 20, no 3, we have 4 times 10, 5, and 8. I think that's all we have. So of those factors, we want to find the factors that can add to the b value. Okay, the middle one never changes. We want to find which ones can add to 3 somehow. Okay, we might have to throw in a negative in some places, but we want to try to get a 3 somehow. And looking at our factors, the only one that we can possibly get a 3 out of is the 8 and 5. So the only way we can get a 3 is if we have an 8 and we subtract 5. So notice again how the negative 20, or this negative 40 was negative. It kind of makes sense that one of our factors has to be negative in order to get a negative answer. So just like the I am factoring, we're going to have x minus 5, then an x plus 8, But we can't forget about our initial AA value, because that's affecting our problem somehow. We're going to divide by 2. Now, this negative 5 over 2 does not simplify like these ones did, so I can immediately move that denominator over as a coefficient on the x and leave the 5. Now, this 8 over 2 does simplify. 8 over 2 is just 4, all right? So I can simplify it to 4, and I don't have to worry about moving a denominator over because that's 1, and moving a 1 in front of an x really isn't going to affect it. So lastly, we cannot forget the negative 3 that we initially pulled out. Okay, can't forget that because that was a part of our problem as well. So there's our factors for the second one. All right, so moving on, this time we actually have equations. And whenever we have equations, we really want to solve or really try to figure out what is the x value or even x values. You might have more than one that work. So in this equation, we want to solve for x. And since this is a factoring lesson, we might want to try to factor. So taking a look at what we have here, this might be an advanced factoring because we have a number in front of our x squared. It's not an easy one like the IM factoring that we can use. So maybe we'll label the A, B, and C again. If you want to even put in a 1 right there to help you out, you can. A times C, we have 6 times negative 2, which would give us negative 12. And those factors of 12, maybe we want to list them again. Some of you might be able to do this in your head. Those are factors. And we want to try into factors that can add to negative 1. That's our B value. Now remember, you might have to throw in a negative somewhere, and it looks like we might have to do that for 3 and 4. In order for them to add to a negative 1, the 4 must be negative. So let's try to throw that in there, because 3 minus 4 is going to give us that negative 1. So we can have x plus 3 and then an x minus 4. And since our initial a value was something other than 1, we need to divide by that A. So our fractions are going to simplify. 3 over 6 can become a half, and 4 over 6 can become 2/3. Now that they're reduced, we can move over the denominators. We have 2x plus 1, and then 3x minus 2. Remember, this whole time, this whole side of the equal sign is being factored. So really, this equals 0, this equals 0, this equals 0. We're just changing the way this left-hand side looks by factoring it. So here's the thing. We need to be a little strategic or tricky on how we're going to figure out what x is. This parentheses quantity right here is representing a number. Okay, I'm just going to use a capital A. We don't know what it is, but it's representing a number. It's a quantity. This other parentheses is probably representing another number, maybe b. And notice how we're multiplying them together, but we know our answer should be 0. So if we think about it, we're taking some number and multiplying it by another number, but we know our answer is 0. What does that tell us about what one of these numbers should be? Now, if our answer is 0, it means that one of these numbers has to be 0. It doesn't matter if I do 7 times 0, because that's 0, or if I do 0 times 7, okay, that's going to give us 0. It doesn't matter if I use a million instead of 7, because if our answer is 0, that means one of these numbers or quantities has to be 0 as well. So let's kind of use that idea to our advantage. So either this quantity, 2x plus 1 equals 0, or the other quantity, 3x minus 2 equals 0. Now that we have equations, we can figure out what x should be. So if I subtract 1 over, we get negative 1, and then if we divide by 2, we get negative a half. So one of our x values that should work in this equation is negative a half, or I might have another one. If I add 2 over and then divide by 3, I get 2/3. So I actually have two solutions, okay, to this equation. Negative 1/2, if I were to plug that in, should give me an answer of 0. And if I were to plug in 2/3, it should give me an answer of 0. Now, if you notice, okay, a little shortcut, notice how up here we had an answer of a positive a half after everything was simplified. And we also had an answer of negative 2/3. Okay, we're dealing with the same numbers, but they have opposite signs. So, little hint, hint, if you can get this far, okay, we're just dealing with the opposite of these coefficients or numbers that we found. So instead of positive a half, our answer is negative a half. Instead of negative two-thirds, our answer is positive two-thirds. And that's just because in the solving process, when we move things over, we are undoing the addition, we are undoing the subtraction, which is in turn changing the sign on these numbers. If we try the next one, very similar to the first one, but the big difference is that this one was equal to 0, whereas this one is equal to negative 3. Now, since 0 played a very key role in us solving this one, we should get this one equal to 0 as well. So that's pretty easy. We'll just add 3 over. So we're left with 8x squared minus 10x plus 3 equals 0. So very similar to the first one. Okay, if we go through this one, no GCF, we can't really pull anything out. So we'll multiply the AC. Air conditioning, I wish the high school had that. All right, so 8 times 3 gives us 24. Let's list some factors. We have 1 and 24. Again, you could probably do this in your head. 2 and 12. 3 and 8. We have 4 and 6. So, of these factors, we want to try to find the factors that can add to our b value, which is negative 10. Again, you may have to be tricky with some negatives. Is there any way we can get negative 10 from any of these? It's actually this one. And in order for us to get negative 10, both of these have to be negative. Negative 4 and a negative 6 give us a negative 10. So we can have an x minus 4 and an x minus 6. Again, this equals 0. But since our initial a value was something other than 1, we got to bring that into play. We're going to divide. So we have x minus a half and then x minus 3/4 equals 0. And again, if you want to use a shortcut, realizing that all we're going to do is switch the signs, our two solutions would be positive 1/2, switching the sign here, or we would have positive 3/4, just flipping the sign there. So there's our solutions. Now, if you can't remember to do that little shortcut, the little hint of just flipping the signs, you can follow the same process of moving over the denominator, just like we did in the other examples, and solving. You should get the same answer. But again, I'm trying to show you shortcuts because sometimes it's just easier to do the shortcut than the long way, and I think we appreciate that, at least most of the time. All right, so last but not least, we're going to talk about the difference in solving an equation like we did in the last two examples, between an equation and a polynomial. Equations, when we want to solve equations, normally you'll hear the vocabulary word of zeros, and that just means figuring out the x-intercepts. And they're called zeros because remember our equation should always be equal to 0. So on a graph, okay, if we think about what this shape might look like, since it's an x squared, we're going to have some type of a parabola. And since we're trying to get it equal to 0, okay, we're trying to get this y value equal to 0. Well, on the y-axis, where it's equal to 0 is actually the x-axis, because remember, one's up here, negative one's down here, 0 is the x-axis. So we might have these points on the x-axis that are equal to 0. So these are what we're actually finding graphically. If we take a look at the last problems we did over here, on the x-axis, we're going to have a point at negative a half and at two-thirds. Over here, we would have a point on positive a half and 3/4. So we're actually finding those x-intercepts. Another vocabulary word you might hear is a root. Okay, maybe you might not hear that one quite as often, but zeros, maybe I'll write this down. Zeros, roots, solutions even, x-intercepts. Okay, they all mean the same thing. Mathematicians like to confuse you sometimes. They all mean the same thing. They're just different vocabulary words you might come across. They all mean the same thing. So in this case, let's get this equation equal to 0. We can subtract the 157 over. So we would have negative 2x squared plus 36x and minus 157. Hopefully you can see that. Now, this one might be really, really difficult to factor because we're dealing with some large numbers. And I don't even think we can do GCF because 236 and 157 don't have a greatest common factor, so we can't really pull anything out. Now, this is the case where our handy dandy calculator probably will come into play to help us out. So if we want to find the roots or zeros or solutions or x-intercepts, they all mean the same thing. We know what they look like graphically because we're trying to find these points on the x-axis. So maybe graphing this equation is going to help us out. So let's go to y equals and type it in. Negative 2x squared plus 36x minus 157. We will hit graph. Now, you might have to change your window. We'll see what this one actually looks like. And oh, we're only seeing part of it. Okay, so maybe we'll change the window. We'll use that zoom fit option. Scroll down all the way to zero. And hopefully this will work out a little bit better for us. Nope, not even, because we want to try to figure out where is it touching that x-axis. So let's change our window for the better. If we changed it back to the negative tens like we had before, negative 10, 10, and 1, it was over here in this little piece. So if we're trying to figure out where does it touch the x-axis, we might want to go just a little bit more to the right. So we're going to go a little bit further to the right on the x. So maybe we'll go all the way to 20. And since we don't have that far left that we need to go, maybe we'll change the x min to 0. And we'll count by twos. We'll do that. So hopefully this will help us out just a little bit more. And there we go. It's a little bit more in the middle of our graph. So right here and right here are the answers that we're looking for. We want to try to find those x-intercepts, zeros, roots, solutions, whatever you want to choose. That's what we're looking for. Now, on our calculator, since they don't, notice how they're kind of in between tick marks, we don't really know for sure what those numbers actually are. There is an option on your calculator that you can use, okay? If you hit second trace, we're going to go to this calc option because we're trying to calculate something. Notice how there's an option that says zero, and after all, we're trying to find zeros. So we're going to go down to zero, select enter, and maybe we'll pick this first point that we're looking for. Take a guess about where it is. Okay, somewhere right there. Now, we're not going to hit anything just yet. It's asking us for a left bound. So we want to go somewhere left of this point. So that actually means somewhere below it. Okay, so maybe we'll hit enter, and you should have this little arrow that pops up. Now it's talking or asking you to choose a right bound. So if we go below the point, this time let's go above it. We're going to kind of trap it in between these two tick marks. So what we're telling our calculator is somewhere in between these two arrows, somewhere right in here is the point we want to find. Now it's asking you to take a guess. So use your arrow button and just take a guess where it is and hit enter. And there it is. So when our equation's equal to zero, when y is equal to zero, we have an x-intercept of 7.41. So maybe we'll take a screenshot, save that. Okay, so there's one of our roots, but notice how we should have another one somewhere on the right-hand side. Okay, somewhere over here. So we'll scroll, oh, trace over. And we're just going to repeat the process. Okay, so second calc. We want to try to find a zero. Now, this time it's asking for a left bound. Now, since we're on the other side, left of this point actually means above it. Okay, so this time we're going to pick a point above it. The right bound this time is actually below it. Again, we want to try to trap it in between these two arrows. And when we take our guess, maybe somewhere right there, it's going to give us 10.6, we'll say. We'll screenshot it. There we go. Okay, so your calculator can help you out with this, okay, especially when they're a little bit more involved. Even when you have decimal answers that are kind of tricky, a calculator might be a good, useful hint for you. All right, real quick before we wrap this up, I just want to show you one more thing. I know I just showed you how to figure out more difficult problems that really aren't able to be factored on your calculator, and we did that over here. But there is a mathematical way you can figure it out. I mean, you could use a calculator because these numbers might be pretty big, but in case you don't have a graphing calculator, you can still figure out the answers or the solutions or these roots and zeros by using the quadratic formula. Hopefully, we all saw this in algebra 2, okay, the opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac over 2a. Okay, I even have a little song to help you remember that. If you want to hear it, just let me know. But just like we labeled in the lesson a, b, and c, okay, those coefficients, they are used here as well. So if you plug in these numbers in the quadratic formula and do the correct order of operations, maybe you need to use a calculator for the square root of 40 part, you do actually get the same solutions. Now, you got to be careful with the plus or minus because you'd have to do negative 36 plus 40 divided by negative 4, and then do negative 36 minus 40 divided by negative 4. That's where you're getting these two answers from, when you do the positive version and then the negative version. And notice how they match the same answers we got on the graph. So just in case you don't have a graphing calculator, you can still solve these equations by using the quadratic formula. Not sure if we realized that when we were going through the lesson, but I thought it was a good heads up. Hey, this is what you can do also. So good luck on the practice, good luck on the application, most of all, good luck on the mastery check. And again, don't be afraid to ask for help. So see you guys next time.